हाय देवाशीष।
हेलो। नहीं हो रहा है तेरे माइक तो देख सुन तो दिन Okay, so everybody can see me. Just say hello. If you can see me, please say something from the Zoom conference room because there are people who can see me, of course.
Yes, we can see you.
Shubha? Yeah.
Yes, yes.
Okay. Okay, so I would like to welcome one and all for this specific. We are going actually live from the lecture theater after almost 1 hour. So I want to welcome all in the audience to have a warm round of applause because you can hear them. My pleasure to have Professor Devashish Das to give the colloquium today. We're going to celebrate. With that, I just wanted to tell all the people in the YouTube audience and the Zoom as well that the Wednesday colloquium is pretty old as a tradition of all the scientists.
Jyotishman,
yeah.
We cannot hear you most of the time. I mean, I think you are not carrying this microphone with you.
You can't hear me?
Are you carrying the microphone with you?
I mean, no, I don't have a microphone on me, but are you able to hear me now?
No, now I can, but when you are slightly behind, we cannot hear you.
It's really choppy, Jyotishman. It cuts in and out.
Okay, could you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so thank you for those pointers and feedback. I just would like to, do it on the fly. So if you just bear with me for 5 minutes, we'll fix that. So for all in the YouTube audience, I just wanted to say that the Wednesday Colloquium is one of the oldest forum for all the scientists for coming together on one particular day on a weekday. And it allows for essentially listening to, experts in different communities, physics, chemistry, and biology. But it allows for all the audience as scientists to get together and listen to that and maybe get affected by what is going on in different aspects of science in contemporary research. It actually was Professor Homi Bhabha's fantastic idea, and it has spurred on collaborations within the institute as well. So I'm very thankful that I get the opportunity to host this evening. And of course, in the audience, both in Zoom and in physical presence, we have previous colloquium coordinators who have gone job of keeping the series alive. So today we have Professor Devashish Das, who is going to be in the video in a moment. Before Devashish comes in, I would just like to give a quick introduction. So Devashish actually joined us almost 2 years back, joined the Department of Biological Sciences. His background, his academic background, actually dates back to his bachelor's of science in chemistry. And this was in Ramakrishna Mission, Narendrapur, and University of Calcutta, where he did his bachelor's from 2001 to 2003. He did his Masters of Science tending towards biology, and this was in biochemistry from 2003 to 2005 from University of Kolkata, and then he shifted mostly to biophysics with his PhD work, again continuing in University of Calcutta with Professor Chanchal Dasgupta. And in this particular part of his work, he actually looked at role of unfolded protein in ribosome recycling. So this is really into biological domain and going away traditional chemistry. His two postdoctoral stints were in the United States. The first one was with Brian Kranz in the University of California, Berkeley. And this was during the time from 2013 to 2016, as I understand, and Brian Kranz actually moved to the University of Maryland. And then he actually continued his postdoctoral work with Edwin Chapman, where he looked at these molecule measurements, which he will present today as a part of his fantastic work. Without further ado, I would like Devashish to come into the video box and present his colloquium, and he can drop his mask at any point. Actually, we can do the caller mic, but
hello everyone, can you hear me? Hello everyone, can you hear me?
Yes,
at the moment.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. So I start. Thank you, Jyotishman, for this nice introduction, and thank you for giving this opportunity to present some of our ongoing work that we are doing in our lab. So. Today, I'm going to tell you about the molecular understanding of movement abnormality in Parkinson's disease. So, I think many of you have heard about this Parkinson's disease, which is ultimately a movement disorder. And in this cartoon, more or less, what are the different kind of symptoms that observe Parkinson's face are kind of shown. Now, this is actually a global problem. And this is a little old estimate of 2017. But nevertheless, you can actually see China is kind of leading the front. And obviously, India and USA is kind of tying together here. And I must say that one of my favorite physics teachers actually died in Parkinson's. So people normally believe that Parkinson is a old age disease, that means which happens like for say 6 years of age. But you do observe some cases, like around say 10 to 15% cases that happens less than 40 years of age. And last 5 to 10 years of research is showing that actually, even if you see the manifestation of the disease at the age of 60, but the molecular events that are actually responsible for this disease start to occur even early 40s or so. So that's why it is kind of, we need a good therapeutic innovation for this disease. So people have been trying to understand the role, I mean, what really causes this disease for a long time. And these are kind of the two key papers where they identified a gene which codes for a protein named alpha-synuclein responsible for this disease. Now, what they found is that they found some mutations in these proteins observed in Parkinson's patients and their families as well. And this is the protein that I'm talking about, which is actually this alpha-synuclein protein, which is ultimately an intrinsically disordered protein. And this protein mainly presents abundantly in neurons and less abundantly it expresses in other tissues like say heart, skeletal muscle, pancreas, and placenta. Now the question really is, what happens in Parkinson's disease with respect to this particular protein. So there are two things happen. Number one, accumulation of alpha-synuclein oligomers takes place within the living cell, within neurons. Now, otherwise, alpha-synuclein is a monomeric protein when it is, you know, present in a normal, like within you, within me, everybody. But at the onset of all, you know, Parkinson's, you see kind of an oligomerization of that protein. And that forms a lot of, you know, cross beta structures as well. So that is one thing that happens. And the second thing what happens is that people have observed abnormal secretion of chemical messengers. That is that actually takes place during Parkinson's. So now, what does this mean? This is basically means that these chemical messengers which help one cell to talk to another cell, that process, that is cell-to-cell communication process, gets abrogated during this condition. During this, you know, Parkinson's disease. So that means basically we are talking about abrogation of two fundamental cellular processes in Parkinson's disease. One is abnormality in this protein quality control mechanism that actually allows the formation of the correct conformation or the functional conformation of the protein within the cell. And we are talking about another, you know, cellular process that gets abrogated is this, you know, as I just said, cell-to-cell communication of the secretion of the, you know, chemical messengers from cell. So I'm raising these two points because our lab particularly interested to understand these two, you know, cellular processes. And that's why this Parkinson's disease and all these phenomena lies right in the middle of these two, you know, cellular processes. So now, I will very briefly touch base upon this protein quality control aspect. So as I said, this alpha-synuclein is produced by the cytosolic ribosomes within the cell. And once it is formed, it can either go to its native fold or it can misfold and form the toxic aggregates like this. So now that is precisely what happens in Parkinson's disease. Now within the cell, once these toxic aggregates are formed, there are machinery to remove these toxic aggregates from the cell as well. Despite of the fact of the presence of all these machineries in Parkinson's, they remain non-functional. And extensive studies have been going on, and you know, try to understand how these relationship, like from these, you know, toxic aggregates and how this protein clearance mechanism might get, you know, broken in Parkinson's, but we still don't know the, you know, clear cut answer. And now people are trying to rather go kind of upstream and trying to understand what really nucleates this process of alpha-synuclein misfolding, rather trying to kind of going there to attend give attention too much yet. Anyway, so what I will try to I will kind of request you to focus on two words in this sentence that I have written here: the accumulation of non-functional alpha-synuclein oligomers in Parkinson's. One is non-functional, another is oligomers. So now, if I point to the oligomer first, we are again coming back to the problem of protein, you know, synthesis and formation of this functional protein. So what we are interested in our lab, try to understand how these newly synthesized alpha-synucleins unfolded conformations are protected inside the cell, and under disease condition, how that form gets misfolded under disease condition. That is, so these are the two things that we are particularly interested in. We are you know, working in our lab to understand these things. And
yes. Maybe you can repeat the question.
Yes.
So what we know is that the motor skills get affected for a person who has this disease, right?
Yeah, yes.
So some of this protein aggregation, whatever that is, it will affect the motor skills.
Yeah, I will come into that. Yeah, that is precisely what, you know, this entire, I am coming there. Okay. I'm coming soon.
So you make the connection, very general.
No, absolutely, you're right. And this is the key thing, like why some protein misfolding is ultimately causing, you know, motor symptom and all these things. That is precisely what I'm kind of trying to hit there.
I hope they heard the question.
Yeah, hopefully.
Okay.
Okay, so now this is the, you know, protein folding and misfolding aspect of it, but I am not going to tell about this in today's talk. What rather I will focus on is the non-functional part of it. So when I'm saying that we are in Parkinson, a non-functional ultrasonic oligomers are accumulating, that means we are actually assigning some function to ultrasonic, right? Some physiological function, and that is what is broken under disease condition. So the first point is, what is the normal physiological function of alpha-synuclein and how does that function abrogate under disease condition? So I will entirely talk about the first point here today, that what is the normal physiological function of alpha-synuclein. Only when you know that, then only we can think about like understanding how that gets abrogated when you see all the misfolding around these things. But now let's see how much we know about that. Okay, so in order to go there, let's just go back and ask the same question again, what I asked before, that what really happens in Parkinson's disease? You basically see, you know, hand tremor and back rigidity. Ultimately, the problem is basically, as you said, there is a motor symptom, right? So if you think a little more carefully, you will imagine it is ultimately you are talking about disruption of the overall synchronization of the human body. That is ultimately what is happening in this disease condition. So now the question immediately comes that what actually controls this synchronized overall human body function. Now when I ask this question, so the immediate answer that comes to my mind is ultimately cell to cell communication. So in this particular case, I'm giving an example of how one neuron talks to each other. What happens is that during this communication process, you have this chemical messengers which are entrapped inside these lipid vesicles within neurons, which are around 40 to 50 nanometer diameter vesicles. They, when fused with the presynaptic terminal, they release these chemical messengers. They bind to the specific receptors which are present in the postsynapse, and that is how this this one neuron communication to another neuron occurs, chemical term. Now, if I zoom in further into this region of this, how this precisely happens, is you're actually what happens is when these vesicles containing these neurotransmitters fuse with the plasma membrane, they first form a small ephemeral pore-like structure. We call that as fusion pore. Now, as soon as this pore forms, and this is general for all, this is not just for neuron specific, it is specific, it also true for say, when cytokines release from immune cells, or say for example, hormones released from endocrine cells. The similar phenomena occurs. The only thing is the time scale changes in different cases. Now, what happens is once this fusion pore is formed within milli to microsecond time scale, or maybe sometime in second time scale, it either closes. We call that as kiss and run mode of exocytosis. So exocytosis is the term that is to denote how the mechanism of release of this chemical messenger. So we call this as a kiss and run mode of exocytosis, or within that time frame, it can also fully fuse with the plasma membrane. So that means you can imagine that this pore structure is so ephemeral that we still don't know the pore composition and how the pore looks like. But that is one of the very key kinetic intermediate that regulates this. This release of these chemical messengers.
Devashish, yes. How long are the time scales?
So what people have done is they have done some electrical recording on cells as well. Now it varies cell to cell. In neurons, it can be from microsecond to millisecond. In say, for example, neuroendocrine cells, it is can be a second. In case of immune cells or say endocrine cells, it is even slow. But people don't really know what's the reason for that.
So the normal function is that you have to have this kiss and run, is it? I mean, it has form and then.
It can be kiss and run. It can be the full fusion.
All these are normal functions.
Normally that happens. Normally all these things happen. although in neuron it has been really challenging to catch this kiss and run events due to this, very fast, couple of studies only were able to actually show it. But other cells which are a little slower, obviously we understand that is much easier to track. So now if you go a little more deep into this process and mechanism, what really happens is, now if you think about it, you're actually talking about fusion of one lipid bilayer with another lipid bilayer, which might not be energetically favorable unless you have some proteins which catalyze these events. And that is what happens by these snare proteins. One class of snares, which is present in vesicles shown here as blue, we call them as V snares or vesicular snares. And another class of protein we call as T snares or target snares, which are shown here as green. When these V snares and T snares come close together, they form a very stable four helix bundle structure that allows or that catalyzes these two membrane merger and allows the formation of the pore and allows these chemicals to release. Now, all these processes have been, these three people actually pioneered in identifying all these different states. And what James Stockman did is he identified the minimal machinery for this process, which are V-snares and T-snares. So forget about cells. Say you have taken one lipid vesicle, so you have incorporated V-snares there, and you have taken another lipid vesicle, you have incorporated T-snares there, allow them to react, it will react, and it will form a fusion pore and everything will work perfectly. And that is what James Norton did. But you can imagine that if these things keep happening inside the cell, then you will have an unregulated release of chemical messengers all the time, right? So it has to be regulated somehow. And that is what Tom Sudov did. What he did is he identified one of the key proteins called synaptotagmin 1, which is a synaptic vesicle resident protein. And what it does, it binds to calcium, it binds to snare, it binds to negatively charged phospholipid in the membrane. By doing all these interactions, it ultimately, it does two functions. One is, it kind of, when you don't have calcium inside the cell, it somehow prevents the vesicular secretion to occur. And when calcium comes in, there is a conformational change occurs, and that allows these vesicles to now fuse in a very regulated fashion and release the chemical content, this content. So now that is kind of the what present understanding in this field. So now, apart from identifying the function of this synaptotagmin 1, what Tom Sudov also did is he worked on this alpha-synuclein, and he showed first that alpha-synuclein promotes the snare complex assembly in vitro and in vivo. I told you this alpha-synuclein is a very abundant protein in neuron. So 1% of synapse, total synaptic protein is alpha-synuclein actually. So we need to assign some function to alpha-synuclein. So he first showed that it is increasing the snare complex assembly. That means we are talking about this complex formation by alpha-synuclein. Now, he also showed that native alpha-synuclein actually induces clustering of vesicles close to the active site from where the cytosis occurs. Despite of the fact that these studies as well as other studies followed in the same line, we still don't know what's the how alpha-synuclein or monomeric alpha-synuclein really regulates the vesicular secretion. What's the reason for that is, from this set of studies, you might imagine that one is actually stimulating vesicle, snare complex formation, another is clustering the vesicles. So they might have a stimulatory effect on the vesicular secretion. But when people went ahead and tried to understand how the vesicular secretion gets affected due to alpha-synuclein, so what they did, so this is a very nice review. And here, what they have done is they have compared all these different studies. And in this particular table, what I'm showing is when they deleted alpha-synuclein, either single or there are three different isoforms of alpha-synuclein altogether. So they deleted one, two, or three, all of them. And then they compared how that affect the isolated neutrons from all these mice, and then they compared how that affect the release. When they did this experiment, if you just compare these three results, these three, you know, these are three different papers. Or in all three of them, you can see ultrasonic knockout, right? Now you see the result in these three. So upward arrow means increase in the vesicular secretion, downward arrow means decrease, dash means no effect. So you will find all the results in all of them. That is the problem. The problem really is when people wanted to go inside the cell and inside the mice and try to understand how this actually affects the secretion, everything is kind of complicated. So that's why we still don't know how it is, you know, regulating this process.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
So I just wanted to know whether the alpha-synuclein is present on the membrane when these are happening or associated with the membrane. And if that is the case, when you say there is a knockout, right? Is this a clean knockout across all possible isoforms or...
So a good question. So alpha-synuclein, first of all, it's a monomeric protein, but I will come into all these things, membrane interaction, so on. Interaction of with membrane is one of the key factors for alpha-synuclein, even if for whatever function it does. So when in our lab, when we isolated, say, a synaptic vesicle from rat brain or say, you know, goat brain, we found that alpha-synuclein present both in monomeric as well as oligomeric form.
On the
synaptic vesicle membrane.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because in some cases, at least for known amyloids.
They do interact.
They
absolutely.
Okay. So there is an interaction and you can find these proteins nearby the membrane while, say, for example, one of the fusion events are happening. So you can find that.
Yes. And we have done some experiment to show that as well. And people have done that. So people found it, you know, at the site of a membrane fusion as well.
I just wanted to point out that this is a nice story that you have this fusion and all those proteins. Mm. But what is sort of not clear to me, at least, the physical conditions that are there, the concentrations, the dynamics of these IPDs.
So I'll come into all these things. Yeah. So these are basically, that's the problem why, you know, there is a problem in understanding the role of alpha-synuclein inside the cell. So then people thought that, okay, since it was so difficult understanding inside the cell, why don't we do the reconstitution? So that means you basically take a bottom-up approach. What you do is, you can reconstitute the membrane fusion using just vesicles containing V-snares. And say, for example, you entrap some dye there inside that vesicle and take another vesicle containing T snares, you entrap some fret pair in there. And then when you allow them to react, B snare will interact and you can actually monitor the fret as a kind of readout for membrane fusion in presence and absence of alpha-synuclein. People have done those kind of experiments a lot. But the problem is twofold. One is, first of all, if suppose I want to know how, as I told you before, this fusion pore is a very critical kinetic intermediate. If I want to know, say for example, whether alpha-synuclein is regulating somehow this fusion pore properties, we won't be able to do this in this kind of a setup. Because as soon as the pore forms, even in this kind of setup, it will kind of freeze fully. So that is first. And the second is the time scale. No way you can go to microsecond to millisecond times using this kind of experiments. So that's why we need to solve both the two problems. Let's just come one by one. So the first is how to trap the pore and study the properties. So in our lab, what we do is, in order to do that, we use nanodisc instead of vesicle as one membrane. So nanodisc is a flat bilayer instead of a circular, you know, spherical shape. So, and that flat bilayer is surrounded by an apolipoprotein layer. So that is why we incorporate V-snares. And what you can do is in T-snare vesicles, you can incorporate some glutamate molecules. So then you allow these two to react and it will form fusion pore. And then the glutamate will come out into the medium. And in the medium, we keep a IGLU sniffer, which is basically a glutamate sensor. That means when glutamate binds to it, you get a fluorescence. And that when you do this, you basically can measure the membrane fusion as a function of time and as a function of
signature spectroscopy.
Yes, basically you measure the fluorescence.
There's nothing else that you can check that way.
You can do a couple of other things, but this assay, you basically check the spectroscopy, absolutely spectroscopy. There are other controls and all these things I'm not going to there. So that you have to check, you know, integrity of it and all these things, how much is leaking and all these things.
Can I request, Devashish?
Yes.
Certain portions of the talk, when you think the slides need explanation, maybe
yes.
Use the cursor for the audience in the Zoom, because this,
oh, this
slide
one?
Is not seen to them, right?
Okay.
This is, yeah, you can use mouse,
yeah, maybe just enhance your explanation.
And even we can see that.
So,
right click, and then you have to select the.
How do I do it?
But at the moment, you get a pointer.
Oh, I see. Okay.
You get a pointer,
yeah.
And you can keep moving.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
You see that now?
Yes.
Yeah, you can use that even for us.
Oh, for you? But I think that will be a little difficult because I can't pull it here.
It's okay. I just gave a suggestion.
Yeah.
If
it doesn't work, if somebody asks.
Yeah, okay. Maybe I'll just go back and
yeah.
Then. Okay.
True. I think you move on.
Yeah. Okay. So so now we have done this experiment in our lab in presence of increasing concentration of alpha-synuclein. And what we found is that with an increasing concentration of alpha-synuclein, you basically see a gradual decrease in the glutamate release from these vesicles. And we are kind of happy in the sense that it showed kind of an inhibitory effect of alpha-synuclein on membrane fusion, which was shown by some people before inside the cell. But you have to remember that it's a mixed result. So we have to explain other results as well. Or we wanted to actually see that why other they at all got all these kind of results. And that is one thing. And the second thing is the time resolution. Obviously, as I said, you this time resolution or no way close to physiological time resolution. So in order to solve these problems, now I will introduce you to another technique. Many of you heard about this technique called planar bilayer electrophysiology. So this technique is there for decades. And people have been studying ion channel properties using this technique for decades. So it is a very simple technique. What I'll explain you very briefly, that you have two different chambers, and you basically, and these two chambers can hold approximately 1 mL of buffer. And you basically paint lipids, literally paint lipid using paintbrush in that pinhole, which is approximately diameter is 159 micron. And once you paint the bilayer there, and these two chambers are connected to two electrodes, which are ultimately connected to amplifier. And so basically that means, say, for example, if you are forming any pore in that bilayer, an ion will start to flow, you get a current, and that is what you measure as a function of time. And since it's an electrical recording, we can actually achieve that microsecond time resolution. But you know, people have been using this technique for a long time to study how the ion channels are formed, ion channel properties. But this problem is different. The reason is here you have one protein will not form the pore. Here one protein in one membrane and another protein has to come from another membrane. That has to come together and form the pore. So, but somehow it's now working, and we can actually measure that pore property. So what we do is initially we introduce T snares into the membrane first, and then I'm not going into too much technical details. And then you add V snare nanodies, and that allows the formation of the that goes there, and that allows the formation of the pore. And ionic flow starts, and you get current. That is what you measure as a function of time. So this is kind of the raw trace how it looks like when you don't have any synaptobrevin in the nanodes. So ND means basically nanodes. Zero means how many copies of synaptobrevin you are incorporating in the nanodes. And this is the three different epochs I'm showing. The raw trace is basically baseline shows no current. When you have
synaptobrevin, what kind of ionic strength do you have in the solution?
So 100 millimolar in Cs and 9 millimolar, 10 millimolar in the trans.
So you have this
delta, delta,
electrochemical.
Yes.
Okay, so EMF essentially. So what actually goes through? The ions pass through?
Yes, potassium ion. We use potassium chloride. Potassium. You are basically observing. So once the pore is formed, as you can see here, this is the closed state of the pore. This is the open state of the pore. Once the pore is formed, this is a stable open state, and this transition from the open state transiently to the closed state, typical like standard ion channel recording. Now, when we observe this pore formation, then we added ultrasonic film to it, monomeric ultrasonic film, and with a real surface, what we found is that through all this intermediate open and closed state of the pore, it is ultimately closing the pore irreversibly. And we are actually observing a single pore property and the effect of ultrasonic in that in the microsecond time resolution. So we are kind of excited. And when you get this result, the first thing what you can do is in the analysis, you can do a current histogram, and that will tell you this is in absence of ultrasonic film. And this is in presence of ultrasonic film.
Okay, so we should do that on site. The raw data. So at the end, you still have events which are opening the
transiently
so
opening.
That can also be explained.
Ultimately it gets closed.
Okay. Yes, for a long time.
But you know the problem is how much you can actually show. We are showing three different epochs, but you know it's really difficult to show. It's actually a kind of a 60 minutes recording.
Right. So predominantly it is closed, essentially.
Yes, essentially. 99.9%. Yes, it is essentially closed. And I think, all these things you can analyze using what I'm showing now. So this is the current histogram. It showed that this is mostly open when you don't have alpha-synuclein. And then when you have alpha-synuclein, you see all this partial open and closed, whatever you say it, and then it is going to fully closed state, and this is this small opening is still there because you are actually analyzing a section of the data.
So and what does the frequency mean here?
This is basically the count.
The count.
Yeah. The. Okay. So and then.
Devashish, can I ask you a question?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So I was wondering, I mean, you have this in the context of something else that's driving release. So this is alpha psych, you're looking at spontaneous events of opening and closing.
Yes,
so imagine a scenario in which you actually have neurotransmitters driving release and alpha synuclein in this mix. Flicker rates of open close probability would shift in your opinion?
Ideally, it should, definitely.
Because it's a question of spontaneous versus evoked.
Yes.
And what would happen in an evoked scenario.
Believe me, Vidita, I mean, I will show you the complexity in a minute. So before we address that, I think we need to even understand how these regulatory factors interact with ultrasound.
Correct.
So it's super complicated.
Right.
You will see in a minute.
Okay. Cool. So, thanks.
Yeah. So, next thing what you can also quantify is, say for example, how long it can stay in its open and closed state. Ultimately, talking about kinetics, open, and that is what I am interested in most, open and closed state. And from there, you can actually quantify the fraction of time the pore in its closed state for a given, say for example, 15 minute or 20 minute time, and that is what you compare with all these different conditions. So when you do that, fraction of time closed as a function of ultrasonic film concentration, that increases, as you can see here, with an EC50 value of around 3 to 3.5 micromolar. So now coming to your physiological, it is around 4 micromolar. So that is kind of the physiological, what people think, but you know, it is kind of really difficult to actually understand. Anyway, so now we are kind of happy with this result, but as I said, I mean, this is, we have to explain other results too, or at least try to understand that what actually happens for other, why people haven't really got this inhibitory effect in many other studies they have done. So that's why we wanted to actually know that what causes this inhibition to actually happen, or what causes this pore closure to happen. Now, in order to understand all these things, we first wanted to do a different study, totally different, you know, biochemical study, where we now wanted to actually check the localization of alpha synuclein at the membrane fusion site. And this is in vitro study, but still we wanted to check that. So what we did is, I'm not going to too much experimental detail, but very, you know, briefly, you have V-snare nanodisc, you have T-snare vesicles, you allow them to react with each other, and in presence and absence of different factors, in this case, alpha-synuclein, you can take different other factors as well. And then when you give it a hard spin, it will, lipid will come down in the pellet with its whatever protein or, you know, interacting. And then you basically have unreacted species in the soup. And then you basically can quantify both of them and get information. And by doing all these things, what we found is that alpha-synuclein does localize at the membrane fusion site. And this localization is dependent on the negatively charged phospholipids present in the membrane. That means alpha-synuclein's interaction with the negatively charged lipids is important for this localization. You can see in the pellet, we could not observe any alpha-synuclein, not that much alpha-synuclein. This trace amount of alpha-synuclein most likely due to its interaction with V-snares, which also people have reported when we actually, you know, use this longer exposure. But we did not really observe any significant, so that suggests that this localization is dependent on alpha-synuclein's interaction with the negatively charged phospholipids. And we also observed that alpha-synuclein increases the snare complex assembly as well, at least twofold in our experimental setup, what people also observed before. We just wanted to verify in our system if that is what.
Now, this is my next question. This is Ulas here.
Yes, please.
I don't know if we discussed this earlier. Is that, do you think alpha-synuclein also reorganizes the membrane locally, and would that actually change the properties?
This is a good question, Ullas. I don't think, not that I know of, that people have actually looked into that, but that can be an interesting thing to look at.
Right, because local membrane order change will also increase or decrease your possibly snare complex assembly, and also about the fusion dynamics, right?
Yeah, right. And another thing is that if you think that both monomer as well as oligomer, they bind in membrane.
Right.
But nobody knows how they differentially, you know, that they got to differentially, you know, alter these properties, right?
Correct.
So that is not known. I think, yeah, that's definitely a very interesting point, and yeah, to look for.
Okay, sure. Good. Thanks. Yeah.
As a just follow-up,
is
something known as how the organization is, how alpha-synuclein is actually interacting with the snare complex? Is it exposed outside to other still exposed, or it is buried with that complex?
So people have identified the region that interacts with the membrane with the membrane in alpha-synuclein, as well as the region that interacts with snares. That is known. That they have done.
But we don't know.
Not
because you think about oligomers, then you have to have interaction within the alpha-synuclein.
Exactly.
So
exactly.
Will that take away this?
Exactly.
So I think the structural organization is important.
Yeah. Can I ask a quick
question? Yes, please. So this very nice result that alpha-synuclein increases snare complex assembly.
Yes, yes.
How does that fit with the earlier table that you showed, where its removal increased? You know, this table that showed variable phenotypes, and one of them was increase in release, right?
When I totally agree with you, and I don't know the answer. So frankly,
I had a follow up question for that.
Yeah.
Do you think that the isoform or the particular snare there would be, you know, assembly in specific cell types would be differentially affected by alpha-synuclein? So if you take T-snare, which is 7 versus, you know, syntaxin 7 versus some other one, which is on the plasma membrane in those cells more enriched, would you expect to have differences? I don't know. I mean, that's one way to...
Absolutely. I think it's a very interesting, you know, direction, Sandhya. So,
you have the assays to assess that, important question to address in the field.
We have to only express these snares first and then do the, you know, bring this construct, and I will be interested to do that for sure in future. But that's a definitely very interesting direction, because you have to remember that alpha-synuclein, all the effects people observe in dopaminergic, most of the effects observe in dopaminergic neurons. I mean, even within neuron, you see a kind of a selectivity in dopamine. And I personally don't know what's the reason for that. So right. then it comes to other cells and tissue types. So yeah, I totally agree.
So it's not as if every neuron has exactly the same snare isoform and complement. So if you have differences in affinity, mm-hmm. then perhaps you can tune it differently, because that increase is particularly interesting, because what you're saying here is it increases snare complex assembly, whereas the phenotype seems to suggest that it might actually, at least in some cases, play an inhibitory role.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with you. But, you know, what I believe is I'll show you, you know, at the end. So it rather is a regulatory role more than if I say it's an inhibitory role. Because I'll show you that, you know, why I'm saying regulatory, because, you know, in absence of calcium and in presence of calcium, two different, you know, things happen. I'll show you. I'll come into
detail. Right. Thank you. Sorry.
Yeah.
Just a quick add to that is that, of course, all of these are in the recombinant alpha-synuclein context, right?
Yes, yes.
And your interactions that you're scoring as negatively charged membrane or lipids is contextual, because there's enough literature to indicate, for example, alpha-synuclein undergoes palm dilation or several fatty acid dilations. I think because that becomes interesting, because there's enough literature to indicate that changes the entire dynamics of membrane association and local complex assembly.
Absolutely, Ullas. You are absolutely right. And we're going in the direction where I am personally interested to understand, you know, enough work has been done with this recombinant alpha-synuclein from different sources. What we are trying to do in our lab is using a newly synthesized alpha-synuclein and try to incorporate all these different parameters there.
Okay,
that's
sure.
Exactly what we're doing now.
Okay, thanks.
Yes, please.
So, this system of yours of using a VLM or say nanotubes, so these are essentially planary nature, right?
Yes.
What is the function of alpha-synuclein depends on the membrane curvature, which is not achieved.
Fantastic question.
Thank you.
Yes. So what he said that, you know, alpha-synuclein ultimately is a curvature sensitive protein. How these experiments, given the fact that nanotubes is a flat lip bilayer, you know, kind of addresses that concern, right? So we have done two different set of experiments to address that. One thing you can simply, you know, check is the snare complex formation. You take two vesicles where you have, you know, now allow them to basically VNT snares incorporating two different vesicles and allow to snare complex formation, and how alpha-synuclein affecting that snare assembly there. And now you compare with the nanodisc and your vesicles, right? And that is absolutely same. I mean, it's there in supplemented. That is one experiment you can do. And another experiment what Bhabhaya standardized, that is optical result, which shows the kinetics of it. The kinetics also remains the same. So nevertheless, whatever, you know, the curvature, since what I believe this curvature sensitivity of alpha-synuclein is more important for this vesicle clustering. That is two. So we are talking about two different function of alpha-synuclein. One is clustering of vesicles, and then we are talking about this pore modulatory function. And for this function, I don't think, you know, alpha-synucleins, at least what our results suggest, is not playing that much role. Okay.
To a layman, why should curvature matter? Is it just facilitating the interaction or something?
Most probably, people say it's a curvature-sensitive protein.
I don't know, but why? I mean, is it that it facilitates the interactions more because it just opens up, it allows a larger area or something?
That's probably that, because you will see in the structure, it's 140 amino acid long protein. The first 90 amino acids are, you know, interact with the lipids. So basically, it's possible what you're saying, that it's kind of just increases the surface. Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
So, from this level, you are saying that the alpha-synuclein is interacting with technically negative lipids.
Yes.
So, is the lipid composition itself will matter, because this it is interacting with snares also and lipid also. But if in this particular, like if it is PC membrane, and where it is only interacting with SNIA, not with the membrane, whether there will be any differential.
Yeah, so I'm coming to that a little more detail in a minute. You will see, I mean, how that regulate the pore properties. So, yeah, thanks. So the fact that we observe that alpha synuclein membrane localization is dependent on its interaction with the negative HS lipids, we wanted to actually go now and try to understand how this property might play a role in its pore modulation. So now this is basically the alpha synuclein protein 140 amino acids long, and this N-terminal region interacts with these negative HS lipids. And the C-terminus interacts with SNARES, that people know. And so the first thing what we did is we omitted all these negative HS lipids from the membrane. And what we found is that we did not observe any change in the pore properties due to the same concentration of alpha synuclein. This is the quantification of the same thing. You see in the current histogram does not change that much at all. And then open lifetime distribution also doesn't change significantly. That means that tells you this negative HS lipids is important for showing this, alpha synuclein pore modulatory effect. Now, since it is also interacting with the SNARES, so the next question is whether that itself is enough or SNARE binding property is important. So in order to understand that, now what we have done is we have taken a small, we deleted the alpha lipid binding region of alpha synuclein from it. And we have taken a basically peptide which mimics the C-terminal region of it, which binds to SNARES. So when we added that in the PC membrane, which is actually neutral, it doesn't have any charge, we observed a very interestingly dramatic change in the pore properties, that now it is destabilizing the open state. And you show all these partial open and closed states, as well as these, some full closures. And this is the quantification of the same thing in the current, as well as in the open lifetime, you also see a shift in the open lifetime. Yes.
And where it interacts in the snare, whether it is in the dipping part?
It interacts with the N-terminus of the snares.
And N-terminus is dipping.
So this is in the snare. That's very, very good point you raised. One thing I didn't have time to tell. So when you are talking about it interacting with SNARE might be important, I will come into that. So we are talking about a dynamic SNARE complex here. That means, there are two different types of SNARE. So when this membrane merger occurs, vesicles coming close to together, and then two different SNARES come close together. First complex that forms, we call that as transnare. That means when these two SNARES are still in the two opposite membrane. And that is what we are talking about here. And that we found previously is dynamic like this. And then comes the very stable C-SNARE complex. And that dynamic transnare is where we believe this alpha synuclein is accessing and then interacting with it. But we'll see it how it is doing that. So anyway, so this is decreasing when you have PC membrane. And then what we did is we included the negative HS lipids again, and then we repeated the same experiment and we found that it is showing the same results. You can clearly see some very interesting, open and closed state and closed state intermediates as well there. And these are all these, quantifications that the current histogram shows this partial open state, and then open state lifetime distribution also in decrease to the shorter open lifetime. Now, although we observed this kind of a dramatic effect in the pore property by only this snare binding domain of alpha synuclein, we did not observe the full stable pore closure, irreversible pore closure that we observed with the full length alpha synuclein. I think that is where the membrane's interaction comes into play. Like we are kind of showing, observing a kind of intermediate sort of state, but still it is kind of quite significant. Then we deleted the membrane binding, snare binding region, and that did not show any effect in the pore property. So that told us that most probably the snare binding, snare interaction is what most likely is regulating this entire process. That is how this is, regulating the pore properties. If that is so, then $1 million question is, when I have full length alpha synuclein present, where you have given snare binding domain as well as lipid binding domain, and you have this negatively charged liquid, why it is not showing anything? And the answer, I don't know. But what we believe is that most likely alpha-synuclein, and that is what we hypothesize here, is that most likely alpha-synuclein present in a self-inhibitory conformation as soon as it comes out from the ribosome. And that is one thing, that is what the hypothesis is. Yes.
Can I ask a question here?
Yes, please. Quickly.
So since you're talking about negatively charged lipids, is it known that this lipid binding site has a specific binding pocket for phosphatidylserine only? Since I noted that the negatively charged lipids that you are using is phosphatidylserine in this case and phosphatidylethanolamine. So is it already known that these have binding sites for these particular lipid head groups?
I can't remember, Onkona, at the moment if that is the case, but I doubt, because people have used other negatively charged lipids as well. And we have also used the PEP2DAG and all these things as well.
So all of them. So it's just, you think it's just an electrostatic interaction?
It is. That's what I believe. But I don't have an experiment or proof, but I believe it is an electrostatic interaction.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what I believe. So most likely an alpha-synuclein present in a self-inhibitory conformation. Now that is one thing that we are, you know, actually interested in trying to probe in the lab, whether these self-inhibitory form do exist in reality and whether that can be a key factor that regulates whether it will go into this misfolded conformation or going to this correct functional folded conformation. That is precisely what we are trying to, you know, answer right now. Now I will go in from here, I will jump to the next section. So far, whatever I told you is what Vidita said is that how regulatory factor, in terms of regulatory factors, how it might affect. So that is precisely what happens inside the cell. So inside the cell, all these membrane fusion are regulated by a variety of different regulatory factors. And one of the key factors is synaptotagmin 1. As I said to you before, this is one of the main key calcium sensor for synaptic vesicle. So what we have done is we have incorporated synaptotagmin 1 along with synaptobrevin, the V-snares, in the nanodisc. And that is what happens in synaptic vesicles. In synaptic vesicles, you have both of them. So, and then we have done these experiments, as I said to you before, that in absence of calcium, if you recall, in absence of calcium, synaptotagmin 1 does not allow the membrane fusion to happen very efficiently. And in presence of calcium, it's somehow kind of stimulating. So if you see this result, this is a kind of in absence of calcium, you see most of the time pore is in its closed state, transiently flickering to its open state, and the pore conductance is also small. But then when you have added calcium in it, you see a kind of a large conductance and you see stable open state of the pore. Under these two conditions, when you added alpha-synuclein, in the first condition, when we did not have calcium there, we found that alpha-synuclein is probably helping synaptotagmin 1 to clamp the fusion further by stabilizing the closed state further, as you can see here. You see these transitions decreased dramatically here. However, with our real surprise, when in calcium was present in presence of synaptotagmin 1, when we added alpha-synuclein, we did not observe any change in the pore property at all. We doubled the amount of alpha-synuclein even if we did not see this happening. That is most likely why you basically observe a number of cases, kind of a conflicting results. One of the origin could be this. And this is the quantification of the same thing. Where this fraction of time closed is quantified, this is the fraction of in absence of calcium it is increasing, and in presence of calcium we don't see any significant change. And this is the open closed lifetime, and that increases in absence of calcium when you added alpha-synuclein, but in presence of calcium it doesn't really change dramatically.
What are the contributors of the calcium concentrations?
Yes, that is a very good question, Jyotishman. So this operates in approximately, say, 0.5 millimolar calcium, which is actually evoked calcium. That means that when if you see the calcium current, it goes, then it goes down, right, like that, or whatever way you draw it. So it operates, this tagmin operates in a very high calcium concentration, but very fast.
Okay.
That is the specialty of this tagging. But there are other calcium sensors as well that needs to be checked as well, how that is operates.
So Debashish, related question to this, in the previous slide you had all the lipids PIP2, PSP, and PC.
Yes.
So what percentages were you using? I mean, was it a mixed vesicle of all of these lipids together or these separately?
No, this is a mixed together, but what we do is we proportionately reduce others and then incorporate. So for example, PEP2, we use 1% PEP2.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
So the calcium dependence actually tells, because there are many phosphatidyl serine binding proteins that will act only in the presence of calcium. So that is why I'm, you know, guessing that maybe this protein might have a calcium and a PS binding site, and that might be the reason why you are seeing these effects with PS and calcium.
You mean alpha-synuclein?
Yeah, in this case, it might have some.
Well, alpha-synuclein doesn't. So when we did this experiment in presence of those are all in supplementary. We did in presence of only calcium, but in absence of some protalmin 1, we did not see any effect. So it probably calcium doesn't have any effect in this case. Only calcium, like alpha-synuclein's effect on membrane fusion, doesn't have anything to do with its interaction per se with calcium. That's what we don't think.
Okay, because some of the PS binding proteins, they synergistically act only in the presence of calcium.
Yeah, no, I know that, Shankuna, and that is precisely why we tested that, but no, we did not see any change. Any change, yeah. Yes.
Have you checked the localization of alpha-synuclein on the membrane or its interaction with snare complex in the presence of calcium? Is that changing?
What he is asking is whether we have did the experiment where we checked whether alpha-synuclein is localized in presence of calcium and all this. I think we have checked that it is there and it does localize at the site.
It is localizing, it is interacting.
But somehow it is inhibitory. But you know, we got that result. It does localize. It does localize in the moment. But still, I would say that it is still complicated because we are, first of all, what Josima said is calcium concentration and other regulators also play the role, because there are multiple calcium sensors present at the active zone which operates in different calcium concentration. So you don't really know whether that result, I mean, this is good in the sense that it is directly showing how it is probably acting with tagmin per se, but other, you know, how that operates.
There is in vitro content, but this is completely, so that is in vivo
contact.
Then this is an in vitro experiment where you have only.
It does localize. Okay, so then what we did is we this is one of the regulators that I showed. Another regulator is monk protein, that what Bhavya is working on. Bhavya, you know, lab PhD student, so she is working with this monk protein, and what she found is that this is the y-axis. I'm not going to the too much detail of this assay, but just take my word. This y-axis suggests that this is the membrane fusion efficiency, and the x-axis is the time, as you can see. So when you don't have, this is an optical measurement, as you can see, when you don't have T-snare vesicles, you don't see any membrane fusion. This blue one, and the black one, when you have VNT snares, we basically see a membrane fusion. It's happening in presence of MONK13, which is another regulators, that MONK13 binds to calcium. That MONK13 binds to calcium, it binds to snare, as well as it binds to membrane. The same thing that happens with the tagmin. However, MONK13 is a cytosolic protein, unlike some protagonist one. So now it stimulates membrane fusion. Now you observe that, and not only this, MONK13 is also increasing the snare complex assembly, as you can see here. With an increasing of MONK13 concentration, you can clearly see a gradual increase in the snare complex formation. So then we wanted to actually check how that how alpha-synuclein operates. Yes.
Is this a MONK problem? Is this the gradation of snare complexation? Is it dependent on calcium also in the presence of MONK?
You got to talk to Bhavya. You will see a lot of interesting stuff going on. Yeah, it depends on calcium. So Now, when in presence of these monk proteins, alpha-synuclein was able to actually close this pore. So, and this is the, you know, the rate when you calculate the rate of pore opening, basically my presence of impurities among them reduces the rate of pore opening. So at the end, the point is how now alpha synuclein is regulating the fusion pore or this membrane fusion. That short answer is complicated. So it depends on its binding to negatively charged lipids. It depends on its interaction with snares. And one thing I did not have time to tell you that it does interact stoichiometrically with the SNPs. We have done that as well by varying these copy numbers and changing the alpha-synuclein concentration. And it depends on variety of different regulatory factors that are present there and in regulating this process. So I think now we will do some experiment. I think other people will also do in some cell-based experiment, try to find the role of alpha-synuclein in the background where you kind of say negate the effect of some regulators and then check the role and then see how they synergistically operate. So that is the story. And now here I'll stop. So this is the workforce. Rohit, who did a significant amount of work in this, and Bhavya also did substantial work, and Kinjal and Shapali helped a lot here. And then and Malavika, Shuleka, and Mayank recently joined. They're working in this protein misfolding, folding that project. And Aditra and Abhiraj Pariklo is working in some related topics. And I thank all of them. And I thank all the TIFR colleagues and DVS staff members, and obviously the funding sources from TIFR and the BAE and SARP. Thank you very much. More question?
Okay. So thank you, Devashish. That was a fantastic talk. It was very clear. And this is the first time we tried the hybrid mode. And I think people, yeah,
it works.
And it works. And and now we will have questions. So those who have come here get the first preference.
Yes.
You said that alpha-synuclein probably is auto-inhibited in some sense in the natural context, and it can act on the membrane, but only in the presence of. So if you delete the membrane binding region, you see some effect on the pore property. But if you have the entire thing, you don't see any effect. So my point is, how do you?
You do see effect when you.
Yeah. So you intend to probe this auto-inhibited formation, which in my mind resembles like a motor. So if a motor, one microtubule-based motor, is auto-inhibited, it's not bound to its cargo. It's the tail and the head interact together, and when the cargo is brought, it kind of binds to the membrane, and that is what opens up the motor, and it can now interact with microtubule and move. So do you imagine something like a multi-domain structure which will open and close in this? And if yes, then how do you intend to probe it? And a follow-up question is, so this membrane binding domain is somewhat enhancing that function of modulating the pore property. So do you imagine this to act like a clamp on the membrane and stabilize that property, which is stabilized only after it has the membrane binding domain?
So yes, so yeah, so the first, I answer the second question first. The question is, if the binding of alpha-synuclein to membrane somehow stabilizes the snare interaction. Yes, you are right. I think that is what not only us, other people have shown there that as well, that the membrane interaction of alpha-synuclein increases the flexibility. I think that is an NMR study or something that shows that it increases some flexibility in the alpha-synuclein. And we believe that is the key for alpha-synuclein to interact with the snares when it is in the full, full length conformation. And coming to your first question, self-inhibitory conformation, that is what I'm extremely interested in that. And we are working towards that. And what the way we are trying to probe and understand this, so we believe that was not observed before, because people have been using alpha-synuclein, like a recombinant alpha-synuclein, and that will not give you this kind of self-inhibitory, because you have to probe the newly synthesized alpha-synuclein, and as it is coming out from the ribosome, how it is interacting with the chaperones or how fast it is interacting with the membrane, and all these dynamics will depend on that. That is precisely what Malavika is doing, and that is precisely what her project is in the lab. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Next question. Yes. Okay.
So my question, thank you. So the new has shown that on snail banding, when the alpha-synuclein bands it has just the snail banding domain and not the negative side domain, it is given the negative side binding, the activity increases. So could go up.
Yes. This one? You have snare bending domain and negatively charged lipid here.
So the alpha-synuclein reverts back to the normal, kind of normal activity.
Yeah, but not full extent. Yes.
But would that be because of some indirect effect of negative charge binding of snare and not alpha-synuclein?
That I can't imagine, because how that happened, because snares are already there.
Alpha-synuclein
doesn't have the negative domain. So no, does interact with the negative.
In this construct, you have created the
yes.
Binding
domain. You are saying that whether
the negatively charged snare binding to the negatively charged membrane. That interaction could affect
if that would have been the case, then we could see it normally when you don't have alpha-synuclein, but this membrane, right? You don't see it.
Right? Okay. Yes.
So what causes polymerization of alpha-synuclein? Are there any known
mutations? Yes. So you said that what is
polymerization of alpha-synuclein also?
What's the question I did? What causes?
Oligomerization. Are there any mutations known in alpha-synuclein that can
induce oligomerization? Yes, there are many alpha-synuclein mutations that induce oligomerization under stressed condition, like say I think A30P or something like that. And when we use those, because we you have to think that this under only stressed condition they induce oligomerization. Not the, so we have done that mutation, and when we added this in this system, it showed some alteration property, but not to the full extent that it does with the full length of something like normal wild type. Yes.
Are you saying something?
No. So you said that what induces oligomerization? Okay, so one more thing I can tell you, that it's binding to lipid does induce oligomerization. That is also known. So, but we don't really know. Say if it is binding to lipid and doing its normal function. It's binding to lipid under stress condition and getting oligomerized. So it is kind of a little difficult to envision. That is what we need to understand. We don't know how differentially these two effects are actually controlling this. It's complicated. We don't know it yet.
Yeah. So if the experts have finished, I have a dummy's question.
Yes, please.
Tell me, firstly, a comment. Are both Alzheimer's and Parkinson's, they are all because of aggregation?
Yes.
So then is there a general thing that when proteins aggregate, this is going to lead to some degenerative disease? Is that a general?
Well, so when you say so neurodegenerative disease, that can be a variety of different,
I agree, but at least just one positive, because amyloid aggregation, that's what I hear.
Yeah.
Sudhito and
people,
that this aggregated, that sort of leads to the Alzheimer's.
Yeah. Yeah. Say one thing you can imagine, that say what we are observing, this alpha-synuclein, monomeric alpha-synuclein, might have some role in regulating pore properties. That means you are saying that monomeric alpha-synuclein somehow allowing this vesicular secretion to occur normally within you and me. Mm-hmm. Say, for example, you have induced Now, like you have Alzheimer, you have Parkinson's. What will happen? You have oligomeric non-functional alpha-synuclein. That will not function properly in that context. That's what I believe. And that's probably one of the reasons why you...
Just to add what Devashish said, so it is more and more being realized now that this oligomerization is the outcome and not the cause of the
disease. So it happens because of something and then
The neurons stop functioning and then the neurons die.
Right.
And once the neuron die, then they release all this into the outside. And then all this,
So all these are all programmed by birth, or is it that the environment, so-called factors?
Yeah, both. Like it can be a familial, like say, you got a mutation, genetic mutation, as she pointed out, then you are more prone to this aggregation. Whereas it can also be like a stress to.
What percentage of people overall, for example,
familial is like, I don't know.
You gave a bar graph initially.
Yeah.
But that's okay. We don't need to go there.
Yeah.
I just want a layman summary of this.
Yeah, yeah.
And dummies.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, this talk for dummies.
Yeah.
So 1 minute, what do I say? Parkinson's, what you have is to get it into the Parkinson's, the role of this oligomerization.
Yeah.
Is that what is the essence of this study?
Yes, absolutely. So the thing is, people don't even know how alpha-synuclein monomer is a very abundant protein. It expresses a lot in neuron, but still we don't know clearly how it, what's its physiological function. It is within you, me, and everybody. So that is the first thing. And if we only know that how it functions, we will be able to tell that under abnormal condition.
Can
how
you it also call the other diseases this kind of malfunction or non-functional?
It can probably cause other associated diseases as well, but maybe I don't know.
Great.
Exactly.
Okay. From the Zoom audience, please put your questions, and we'll look at the chat box also.
Next time you might be.
That is me. Okay, it's all about the talk. Okay. Audience in Zoom?
Are there in YouTube any questions?
No, YouTube there is not actually. Anybody has a question?
Hi, JD. May I ask a question?
Yes, please. Yes.
Okay, so I would like to ask whether you have considered the role of chaperone-synuclein interactions in your studies, because a very recent study from Sebastian Hiller's group has shown that if you somehow abrogate chaperone-synuclein interactions by, say, phosphorylating the tyrosine 39 residue in the N-terminal region of the protein synuclein, then synuclein like translocates to mitochondria, and even in the Lewy bodies that are formed in these patients, Parkinson's patients. So in the Lewy bodies, mitochondria is one of the major components along with synuclein.
Yeah, so that is precisely what we are working on right now. We have not done that here. But yeah, you are absolutely right. Not only one particular chaperone, there are thousands of chaperones that are known to interact with alpha-synuclein. So for example, one of the proteins that I already showed, MONK18, that is, there is paper showing that MONK18 chaperones alpha-synuclein as well. That's why, we are taking the approach of, synthesizing alpha-synuclein or probing the newly synthesized alpha-synuclein inside the cell as well as outside the cell. And we will there address this question, but no, here we have not. Yes.
Thanks.
Yep.
Thank you, Mandar.
Thanks,
other,
Judy.
Yeah. Any other questions or comments or discussion points? Okay, if there are none, let's have a warm round of applause for also I would like to point out, and I'm walking into the video box now, we will again reassemble with a physical colloquium next week. Professor Shirup Rai Choudhury is going to give a special in memoriam colloquium on Steven Weinberg, the first of its series. And I would like to look forward, not just the physicists, but also some of you biologists to join, because some of these contributions of Weinberg is
is deep, and not only in theory physics, but it applies to some of our understanding of the universe, right? So we would like all of you to join in, okay? Whether through Zoom or for physical. Yeah. Thank you. And thank you, Mistry ji, for doing all the stuff that you do.
Good talk, Devashish.
Thank you.
Very nice, clear.
Thank you.
Well balanced. And
I mean, even dummies could understand something.
So where does parking come into this show? How many